حبيب الله. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، وصلى الله على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to a new edition of our program Guardians of the Pious. Today's episode is number 245. And by the grace of Allah, that is our third in explaining chapter number 56, which is under the title of فضل الجوع وخشونة العيش, or the excellence of living a simple life and being content with the little. Today, inshallah, we'll begin with a hadith which is narrated by one of the great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is Anas ibn Malik. May Allah be pleased with him. Before we mention the hadith, I would like to remind you, brothers and sisters, Anas ibn Malik have served the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 10 complete years. His mother brought him to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he arrived to Al-Madinah as a muhajir. And she said, I cannot find anything to give you as a gift but my son to serve you. So Anas ibn Malik was so lucky that he accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 10 years, and he have learned a lot from him, more than most of the companions, because he used to be with him at home, and while in his privacy, while he's resting, while he with his family. So he had an access to a lot of things that most of the companions did not have an access to. So when he tells us something that for sure that he has experienced firsthand, 10 years is plenty of time. You know, when you hire a maid or somebody to clean up the house or a catering, and they stay for a few hours at home, they right away pick up some of your habits, and they know that you are either a generous person or a stingy person. You're a quiet person or a person who shouts, just simply for staying with you for a few hours, for a day or so. What about somebody who lived with you for 10 complete years? That was Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu. So Anas says in this hadith, لم يأكل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على خوان حتى مات وما أكل خبزا مرققا حتى مات. The word خوان may be pronounced as خوان or خوان. Both pronunciation are correct. And الخوان refers to a dining table. Not necessarily a typical dining table of ours, but it's a dining table elevated from the ground. A few inches, or maybe the length of a ذراع, depending on what kind of dining table that they used to use. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived a very simple life that Anas ibn Malik, who have served him for 10 years, says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never ate on a khiwan or a khuwan, which is a dining table. So how did he used to eat? He used to eat while the food is on the floor, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وما أكل خبزا مرققا حتى مات. And he never ate a soft bread throughout his life until he died, peace be upon him. In another narration, because the earlier narration is collected by Imam al-Bukhari, may Allah have mercy on him. In another narration, he said, ولا رأى شاة سميطا بعينه قط. Which means, and he never ever saw a roast lamb in his life. If he never saw a roast lamb before, that means he never tasted it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is very amazing. The Prophet, peace be upon him, if he wanted, he could have lived the life that he desires. He could have eaten the best of food, not just a roast lamb, or not just a fine bread, soft bread, white bread. No. Many of us nowadays do not eat the white bread. They eat the barley bread, the dark bread. Why? Because of they are on a diet or because they are diabetic. But eating this kind of bread was simply an indication of living a simple life, of poverty, of humility, of being very humble. As we will be studying in other ahadith, that they never sieved or screened the barley. They would grind it and they will blow the husk. Then they will make the dough and bake the bread like that. It's very rough. Never ate a fine bread or a soft bread, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, throughout his life. Many of our children nowadays, if the bread has been at home for a day or so, they won't eat it. They can heat it up in the microwave, but it's old. We need a fresh bread. It's soft and it's white. But if we can buy the fresh bread, why shall we eat this bread? So this bread ends up in the trash can, thrown in the trash. While, as it is no secret no more, that we know that hundreds of thousands of people die out of hunger. They don't have this leftover bread, let alone packs of bread being thrown in the trash because it's a day or two old, okay? In addition to plenty of food, meat, rice, and all of that. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have lived a very simple life by choice. Why? Because he perceived the life of this prison life as it should be, as a transient life, as a very short and brief life. It is not worth wasting your life in order to get the fine food and the luxurious place to live in and the latest car. He was aiming at a greater goal, which is the hereafter, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. وَلَا رَأَى شَاتًا سَمِيطًا بِعَيْنِهِ قَطْ. And he never saw a roast lamb in his entire life. Now, with regards to eating on the khiwan or the khuwan, I think we may have a picture of that. We grew up at home, as most people, eating on the floor. There is a little elevated table, just a few inches elevated from the ground, and the entire family would surround it, and the entire family would eat from the same plate and with their hands and so on. This is perfectly fine. And eating with the this is the khuwan, very humble one, okay? It's a round table and it is not a fancy dining table, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not even sit on a khiwan or a khuwan like that. Rather, he would eat on the floor. A question which is raised, because some people will take this and say, then it is a sunnah to eat on the floor and it's not permissible to sit on a dining table. You go to attend a meeting or a party or you're invited here or there and you leave the people sitting on the dining table and say, this is not permissible. The sunnah is to eat on the floor. And another would say that it's not permissible to eat with the fork or with the spoon. It is not permissible to use the knife. You should eat with your hand and it's not permissible. No one said so. If you want to eat with your fingers, do that. No problem. May Allah bless you. But if you use a fork, if you use a spoon, it is permissible likewise. If you want to sit on the floor, that is fine. That's called sunan al-adat. It is natural practices that the Prophet ﷺ did not order his companions to sit on the floor and eat on the floor. He did not say that it is not permissible to sit on a dining table. No. But he chose to live a humble life In the sound hadith, according to Sheikh Al-Albani, may Allah have mercy on him, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَكُلُ كَمَا يَأْكُلُ الْعَبْدُ وَأَجْلِسُ كَمَا يَجْلِسُ الْعَبْدُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I'm just a servant. The word abd here refers to the slaves back then, who used to live a very humble life. So the masters will be sitting on their couches or reclining on their cushions and eating. The Prophet ﷺ forbade so. He disliked eating while reclining. No, this is not how to respect the food. He sit down and eat. He also disliked standing up or walking while eating, or eating while walking. Sit down. Now we say it is a sunnah to not eat while standing, not to drink while standing, not to eat and drink while walking, but it is permissible though, in case that you need it. So, a combination of the ahadith, because the Prophet ﷺ disliked it in some ahadith, but it has been narrated that after he performed tawaf, he ordered Anas, he brought him some zamzam water, and he drank while standing. Why? لِيَرْفَعَ الْحَرَجَ عَنْ أُمَّتِهِ. Not to make it hard on his ummah. So that if you don't have an access to sit down, if you are on a hurry, or if you're somewhere in the street, and you're grabbing a drink of water, and you cannot sit down, it is permissible to drink while standing. And it is permissible to eat while standing. But it is preferable when you have an access to drink or eat to do so while sitting down, while resting. And it is permissible to sit on a dining table, and it is permissible to eat using the fork and the knife or whatever. As long as you eat with the right hand, you hold the spoon with the right hand, the fork with the right hand, whenever you are introducing the food to your mouth. Why? In the hadith of Umar ibn Abi Salamah, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that when I was a child being fostered by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, في حجر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وكانت يدي تطيش في الصحفة. His hand used to wander around in the صحفة or the plate where they all ate from. So he would pick a piece of meat from here and another from there and so on. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taught me. He said, يا غلام سم الله. Now this is a must. We understand that the Prophet ﷺ taught us this is the prophetic tradition. It is not a natural tradition. Whether you do it or you don't, it's up to you. No. Do not eat without saying Bismillah. وَكُلْ بِيَمِينِكَ. And eat using your right hand. Now this is a religious duty. And it is a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ while eating or drinking to use your right hand. As long as you can use your right hand. وَكُلْ مِمَّا يَلِيكَ. And eat from right in front of you. Do not wander around in the plate. If the plate is serving many people, do not eat from this end and from this end and from in front of this person or from the middle. Because the barakah is centered in the middle until you come to it. So everyone would finish what is in front of him until we come to the middle. But do not begin with it. This is sunnah. It must be followed. And when the Prophet ﷺ saw somebody was eating with his left hand, he said to him, "Kul bi yaminik." He had instructed them before that we should eat with the right hand, because Satan eats with the left hand, drinks with the left hand. Obviously here I'm not addressing the secular. I'm not addressing those who are very allergic to religion and religious practices, though they bear the names of Muhammad. Muhammad is the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or Ahmed, or Mahmud, or their parents are Muslims and they give birth to them and they brought them to this life as Muslims, but they hate Islam so much that they pick on the prophetic traditions. They oppose any Islamic traditions. If they see us teaching our children the Quran, say, look, backworded. retarded. People are learning science, math, algebra, and this and that, and they're teaching them the Quran. Yeah, we too are doctors and engineers, and we memorize Quran, and we love the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we love to learn the Deen more than learning anything else. But we're not saying that we're not learning anything else. We excel in every field, alhamdulillah. What is your problem? What is your problem? You hate the Deen so much that you only pick on and you criticize those who try to practice the Sunnah. Look at his beard. He looks like Satan. Is that right? Is this how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions look like? Do you know whom you're making fun of? Huh? Do you know whom you are mocking at? You're criticizing the Sunnah of the greatest man ever. And his traditions, once he instructed to do, then we must do it. When we are introduced to the Sunnah, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would ask about the Sunnah in order to do it. Awfully, at-tabi'een would come to any of the companions and say, teach us what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do in these circumstances. How did he used to eat? How did he used to drink? How did he used to, and so on. Why? In order to do it. Nowadays, it is very weird. It is very strange. It is a time of the ghurba and strangeness. People ask the question, and then when you tell them that it's an emphatic sunnah, then they will say, oh, so it's not a wajib though. Why? I thought it was a wajib. Now, alhamdulillah, I don't have to do it. They belittle it. Sunnah. لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. Verily, in the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, is a role model, is a great example for you to follow. But for whom? For those who hope to meet Allah the Almighty on the Day of Judgment. يرجو الله واليوم الآخر. And remember Allah much. Yeah, the religiously committed people. Those who love Allah, those who love His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they authenticate this love by imitating their most beloved, Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nowadays, you may see your son coming home with a very strange haircut, shaving both sides, erecting the middle hair. What is this? Oh, this is like so and so, the soccer star, the basketball star. I'm a big fan of this singer or this dancer. So they dress like them. They get a haircut like them. They even imitate them in the way they talk. They talk the talk and they walk the walk like them. Why? Because I'm a big fan of you. He's my idol. Allahu Akbar. May Allah have mercy on us. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the end of the last of the messengers and all the messengers before him have been sent by Allah the Almighty to demolish the idols and eliminate paganism and teach people monotheism and the youth of the Muslim ummah are taking idols of human beings. They do not understand the gravity of saying this word, human idol. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Our role model is none but Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and only those who hope to meet Allah on the Day of Judgment in good shape, in good condition, and remember Allah much, would do so, would take him, peace be upon him, as their role model and their greatest example to follow. So if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specified to do a certain act which was a normal tradition, it becomes a sunnah. That's why when he said to this man, who is using his left hand in eating, he said, "Kul bi yaminik," use your right hand. He said, "I can't." And the Prophet ﷺ sensed from him the sense of arrogance and pride. Like, how can you teach me in front of people how to eat? I know how to eat before you were born. Huh? So the Prophet ﷺ again said to him, "Kul bi yaminik," use your right hand. "I can't." Again, "Kul bi yaminik," and he exceeded the limit and he ran out of chances. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, "La astata'at." Every time he said, "La astati'a," "I can't," he said, "May you never be able to." And he was never able to lift his right hand afterward. Oh, now, this is not an ordinary sunnah. We must, whenever we eat or we drink, use the right hand. But if you want to eat with the spoon, you can. No problem. If you want to eat with the fork, you can. You want to sit on the floor, fine. You want to sit on the table, fine. So there are certain acts which we have straightforward guidance. Do not eat while reclining. Do not eat while lying. Do not eat while walking. Okay? Do not eat with the left hand. We know now we have certain guidance in this regard. From Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, we're going to learn a lot. Imagine that he had the honor of serving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and accompanying him for 10 years. And he was not any servant, nor was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was any master. He says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "May Allah be pleased with him, I have served the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, for 10 years. He never told me for anything that I did, why did you do it? Nor did he ever tell me for anything that I did not do it, why didn't you do it?" He's very easygoing. And he said, "I have never touched anything softer than silk than the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Have never smelled anything better than the musk, than the smell and the fragrance of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." Allahu Akbar. He once said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him to do something and said, "Do not tell no one." He was young. So when his mother called him and she said, "Where are you going?" He said, "The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent me to do something and he said, do not tell anyone." So his mother says, "Make certain that you do not tell anyone, not even me. Keep the Prophet's secret," training the youth to be honest. Training the youth through having a role model, an example to follow, not instructing them to do something while the role model are breaking the rules. The elders are doing something different, because in fact, and no doubt, that actions speak louder than words. The following hadith is hadith number 494, is narrated by An-Nu'man ibn Bashir. May Allah be pleased with him. We all know An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, whose father once wanted to give him a property or a gift. Then his mother said, "Go and ashhid Rasulullah. Make certain that the Prophet ﷺ would bear witness, would witness that you have given this property to An-Nu'man." The Prophet ﷺ asked Bashir, An-Nu'man's father, "Do you have other than An-Nu'man? You have children other than him?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Did you give each and every one of them similar to what you gave to An-Nu'man?" He said, "No." He said, "Then ashhid ala hada ghayri fa inni la ashhadu ala zur." Find somebody else. Find somebody else, because I do not testify to falsehood. We learn from him this incident that it is not permissible to favor any of the children over the other. He said, قال لقد رأيت نبيكم صلى الله عليه وسلم وما يجد من الدقل ما يملأ به بطنه. رواه مسلم صلى الله عليه وسلم. An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, narrated that I have seen your prophet, peace be upon him, when he did not find enough of even the adqal, the very low quality dates, to fill his stomach with, subhanallah. To that extent, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam lived a very humble life. We'll take a short break before we come back with another hadith. Please stay tuned.
Rasulullah, Habiballah. Rasulullah, Habiballah. Rasulullah, Habiballah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome back. The following hadith is hadith number 495, narrated by the companion Sahl ibn Sa'd al-Sa'idi, may Allah be pleased with him. قال ما رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم النقي من حين ابتعثه الله تعالى حتى قبضه الله تعالى. فقيل له هل كان لكم في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مناخل؟ قال ما رأى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم منخلا من حين ابتعثه الله تعالى حتى قبضه الله تعالى. فقيل له كيف كنتم تأكلون الشعير غير منخول؟ قال كنا نطحنه وننفخه فيطير ما طار وما بقي ثريناه. رواه البخاري. Sahl ibn Sa'd, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, had never seen bread made of out of fine flour throughout his life. Since Allah the Almighty sent him with the message until his death, he was asked, did you not have sieves at the time of the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him? He replied, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, never saw a sieve. He was asked, so how did you guys manage to eat barley bread made of unsieved flour? He said, radiyallahu an, we used to ground it and then blew away the husk, and what remained, we kneaded it into dough. The hadith is collected by Imam al-Bukhari, and the word an-naqiy refers to the bread which is made out of fine flour. It is called al-huwara. And the word sarraynahu, the last word in the hadith, means to make a dough. Yani kneaded it into dough. What do we have here? That's another companion. He's narrating the same. Anas ibn Malik is narrating the same. Aisha radiallahu anha is narrating the same. So we have people from outside, we have people from inside, we have the servants, we have his wives, we have his companions. His life in public was not any different than in private, except in one thing. In private and at home at night, he would stand up in prayer until his feet would swell. And Aisha would ask him to take a break, to calm down, to rest. And she would remind him, you already have a promise that no one shall enter paradise before you. Why burden yourself so much? And he replies saying, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبَدًا شَكُورًا. Shouldn't I be a grateful servant to my Lord? And otherwise, his eating habits, what kind of food he would eat, whatever was inside, was outside, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Very unique leader. Many leaders who inspire their people to bear the suffering, the hunger and the thirst, patiently, for the sake of their country, for the sake of whatever, and they're drinking water imported from France. The water is imported from Europe. And I swear to Allah, I met some people who used to do the catering for some of the presidents of some countries where people, I would say 30% of the citizens of this place under the line of poverty. And the rest are just living a very humble life, very, very poor country. And he used to tell me that dinner would come on a private plane from Paris. The dinner would come from Europe for the children of Mr. President. Why? Because the food in the entire country is not safe enough, is not delicious enough, is not good enough for them. They're so spoiled that the dinner would come fresh from Paris. And I've sat with some people where the food would come to them by plane from another country. Subhanallah. And when they fall sick, they will never be treated in their countries. They're only ripping off their countries. But for the treatment, for the spending, right away, overseas, in Europe, they don't trust their own people, their own doctors, their own clinics. They're not good enough to treat your highness. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever Aisha narrated is whatever Anas narrated, whatever Nu'man ibn Bashir narrated, Jabir ibn Abdullah on the battlefield, Sahl ibn Sa'd, Sa'di, may Allah be pleased with him. There is a general consensus, an agreement to the humble life that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose to live. Why? Because his ummah, they have some poor people. They have Ahlul Suffa. When everybody eats, then I will eat. We will learn in the future a hadith in this chapter, which we studied before, how when Abu Huraira was starving, then he invited home for some milk, and he gave everyone to drink, then Abu Huraira, and he was the last, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then in another incident, Mujabir ibn Abdullah invited the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because he was tying two stones against his stomach out of hunger while digging the trench. Each companion was tying one stone, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam too. So Jabir prepared a little bit of meal for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he invites the entire army of 1,000 who were digging the trench, and he would be the last to eat sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the bread they used to eat was unsieved. And this is not any flour, the barley flour. Flour made out of barley. And you know the husk is very rough, you know. So Sahl ibn Sa'd said that I have never witnessed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam eating this very fine bread made out of white flour, sieved flour. Screened. You know the sieve? I don't know. Have you seen a sieve before? To screen the flour. Oh, that's a sieve. The Prophet ﷺ never ever saw a sieve in his life, which means he never experienced bread which was made out of sieved flour in his entire life. Very tough life. And the bread which is made out of barley, the people who were asking Sahl ibn Sa'd that, wait a minute, and how would you guys eat this bread which is made out of barley? What about the husk? He said, we would grind it, then we would blow the husk away with their mouth. No screening, no sieves, nothing. And the Prophet ﷺ was like that. Sahl ibn Sa'd is being very, very specific and accurate when he says, مِنْ حِينِ ابْتَعَثَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى حَتَّى قَبَضَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. Why? Al-Ba'tha started at the age of 40. And you guys know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to be a merchant, and a very successful merchant. And this is how he got to know Khadija, and how Khadija got to know about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when she sent Maysara, her servant, to keep an eye on him when he was leading one of her caravans, and it was very profitable. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam traveled a couple times to Asham for trade. And in Asham, they used to eat the very fine bread and very delicious food. You know, it was a territory of the Roman Empire. So when Sahl ibn Sa'd says, "Min حين ابتعثه الله تعالى," he's being very accurate. For sure, since Allah the Almighty commissioned him or sent him with the message of the prophethood until his death. How many years? 23 years. 23 years. Anas ibn Malik narrates, "I have never seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam eating whatever." That's 10 years because he has served him for 10 years. And this is the period which he lived after the migration. Aisha radiallahu anha, similarly, they got married after the migration. But Sahl ibn Sa'd is saying that ever since he was commissioned by Allah as a prophet until he died, he have never seen a sieved bread or an-naqi, which is made of a very fine flour, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the word tharraynahu, which means after they ground the barley, then they blew away the husk, they would knead the remaining flour and make it into dough, then they will bake it. The following hadith is a very interesting hadith. We did have a chance to discuss it before, but not fully. And now, and for the first time, we'll study the full hadith. I want you to bear with me because it's kind of long. It's hadith number 496. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال خرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم أو ليلة فإذا هو بأبي بكر وعمر رضي الله عنهما فقال ما أخرجكما من بيوتكما هذه الساعة قال الجوع يا رسول الله قال وأنا والذي نفسي بيده لأخرجني الذي أخرجكما قوما فقام معه فأتى رجلا من الأنصار فإذا هو ليس في بيته فلما رأته المرأة قالت مرحبا وأهلا فقال لها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أين فلان قالت ذهب يستعذب لنا الماء إذ جاء الأنصاري فنظر إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وصاحبيه ثم قال الحمد لله ما أحد اليوم أكرم أضيافا مني فانطلق فجاءهم بعذق فيه بسر وتمر ورطب فقال كلوا وأخذ المدية فقال له رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إياك والحلو فذبح لهم فأكلوا من الشاة ومن ذلك العذق وشربوا فلما أن شبعوا ورووا قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأبي بكر وعمر رضي الله عنهما والذي نفسي بيده لتسألن عن هذا النعيم يوم القيامة أخرجكم من بيوتكم الجوع ثم لم ترجعوا حتى أصابكم هذا النعيم رواه مسلم. I feel very happy and delighted when I read the Arabic text of the hadith, brothers and sisters, and I hope inshallah that you benefit out of that and you do the same. And now with the meaning of this very interesting hadith, which is narrated by Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that once the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, came out of his house one day or one night, and there he met Abu Bakr and Umar, may Allah be pleased with both of them. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, "What made you leave your houses at this hour?" They said, "It is hunger, O Messenger of Allah, we're hungry." He said, "By him in whose hands my soul is, what made you leave made me also leave. So come along. Whatever brought you out of your homes is the same what brought me out of my house. So come along." And he went along with them to a man from Al-Ansar, but they didn't find him in his house. When his wife, the wife of this man, saw the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, she said, "You're most welcome." The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, asked her, "Where is so-and-so?" He means her husband. She said, "He went to fetch some fresh water for us." In the meantime, the Ansari man showed up. He came back. And he saw the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, and his two companions. Then he said, "Praise be to Allah, today no one has more honorable guests than I." He then went out and he brought them a bunch of date fruit, having dates, and some still green, and some ripe, and some fully ripe. And he requested them to eat from it. He then took his knife to slaughter a sheep. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw him, and he said, "Iyaka wal halub, do not slaughter a milch sheep." So he slaughtered the sheep from them, and after they had eaten and drunk to their fill, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said to Abi Bakr and Umar, may Allah be pleased with both of them, "By him in whose hand my soul is, you will certainly be questioned about this treat, about this delight, about this joy on the day of resurrection. Hunger brought you out of your homes, and you do not return to your homes till you have been blessed with this treat." Allahu Akbar. The word Al-Mudya, and it is also to be pronounced Al-Midya, both means the knife. Al-Izq refers to the bunch of a palm tree bearing the dates, whether it is ripe or half ripe or fully ripe or dried dates. I guess we have an image of this palm branch bearing the dates. It's very important to see it. So what we have in this hadith, that Abu Bakr wa Umar radiyallahu anhuma, and both of them, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was so rich, this is al-izq, and he sees some, mashallah, beautiful, beautiful dates. You know, in one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Baytul la tamra fihi jiya'un ahlu." We should always keep dates at home, whether ripe, have ripe or dried dates. It's very healthy. It is very nutritive. And if you're hungry, a few dates will suffice you until the food is ready or until Allah will bless you with any other source of food. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came out one day and he was hungry. He didn't know what to do. And there is nothing at home to eat. Obviously, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he calls upon Allah, he would send down a table spread with food. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remember what I said, عبد الرسول, rather I choose to be a servant and a messenger, not a king and a messenger. And the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were never like the disciples of Jesus, peace be upon him. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah the Almighty says, mentioning this very dialogue between Al-Hawariyin, the disciples, the chosen students of Jesus, peace be upon him, and Isa alayhi salam. إِذْ قَالَ الْحَوَارِيُّونَ يَا عِيسَى ابْنَ مَرْيَمَ هَلْ يَسْتَطِيعُ رَبُّكَ أَن يُنَزِّلَ عَلَيْنَا مَائِدَةً مِنَ السَّمَاءِ قَالَ اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. Look, they asked Isa alayhi salam bluntly, in a very rude way. They said, "Can your Lord send down upon us a table from the heaven, spread with plenty of food?" He said, "Behave yourselves. اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, if you truly believe." They said, "Well, نُرِيدُ أَن نَأْكُلَ مِنْهَا وَتَطْمَئِنَّ قُلُوبُنَا وَنَعْلَمَ أَن قَدْ صَدَقْتَنَا وَنَكُونَ عَلَيْهَا مِنَ الشَّهِدِينَ. They even made it worse. It is not that we are hungry and we want to eat. No, and also to make sure that we're following the right guy. وَنَعْلَمَ أَن قَدْ صَدَقْتَنَا, and to make certain that you're saying the truth, you're not lying. After all, After all the miracles, subhanallah, after all the signs which Allah the Almighty displayed on the hands of Jesus, peace be upon him, bringing back the dead to life by the leave of Allah, shaping things out of clay, then breathing the soul into it, then it will become living by the leave of Allah, and all of that. Treating the congenital blindness and leprosy by the leave of Allah, and they said, وَنَعْلَمَ أَن قَدْ صَدَقْتَنَا, and to know for sure that you're telling us the truth. Subhanallah. Oh, no, no, no. The messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah blessed them with his companions, as he blessed them with the company of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they were hungry and they were patient, no complaint. They ate with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the leaves of the trees until it sore their cheeks. Subhanallah, they were imprisoned in the valley of Abu Talib for 3 years. They suffered a great deal, no complaints. We're following the right man. We are on the straight path. Subhanallah. And Al-Ansar, they say to the Prophet ﷺ, by Allah, if you cross the sea, we'll cross it with you. We will never say to you what Bani Israel said to Musa ﷺ. They said to Musa ﷺ, اذهب أنت ربك فقاتل إنها هنا قاعدون. You go and your Lord, you fight, we'll be waiting for you. Rather, we say, اذهب أنت ربك فقاتل إن معكما مقاتلون. We will join you. If you cross the sea, we'll cross it with you. We are with you in every condition, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His companions have been chosen by Allah. Abu Bakr used to be very rich, and he donated once his entire money, his entire wealth, to the point that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, Ya Abu Bakr, what did you spare for your family? What did you save for them? Guess what? He said, أَبْقَيْتُ لَهُمُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, I have saved for them Allah and his messenger, peace be upon them. What am I going to do with cash if I have the source of the provision with me? Subhanallah. Umar ibn Khattab once donated half of his entire wealth on the battle of Tabuk. So these guys who used to be rich, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq used to buy the slaves in Mecca so that he would free them for the sake of Allah. Not waiting for any thanks or gratitude. But now he is hungry. Umar is hungry. The Prophet is starving. So he says, let's go to this Ansari man. And he prepares for them this feast. And the Prophet ﷺ tells him, he saw him taking the midya or the mudya, ready to slaughter a sheep without making a noise. He said, make certain that you stay away from the milch one, the one which brings milk. So he prepared it, and he introduced it to them. So they ate to their fill. Then they thanked Allah the Almighty. Then the Prophet ﷺ reminded his companions, Abu Bakr, Umar, the first and the second in the list of the 10 heaven-bound companions. By Allah, you will be questioned about this delight, about this feast on the Day of Judgment. What about us? What about our manners in eating and drinking? How many times we say, thank you Allah for what you have provided for us. May Allah the Almighty guide us what is best. May Allah the Almighty keep us all steadfast on the straight path. Brothers and sisters, by that we've come to the end of today's edition of Gardens of the Pious. To be continued, inshallah, in the next time. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Rasulullah, Habib Allah. Rasulullah, Habib Allah. Allah, our God, is the greatest. One and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest. The one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling their best with the cheapest price.